I'm having you be seated because I want to give you a little bit of background to this scripture before we read it. The scripture today is from the book of Isaiah. Now, Isaiah is prophecy, and these scholars believe that Isaiah was written by at least two different prophets. And so chapters 1 through 39 of Isaiah are all about the sin and judgment that God is going to bring upon the people of Israel because they have sinned against him, because there have been so many kings who have gone against him because of idol worship and forgetting God. But in chapter 39, at the very end, it changes. And the good king, Hezekiah, is visited by the prophet Isaiah. And the prophet Isaiah says to him, in the future, Israel will pay for their sins by going into exile in Babylon. And this is the best, I just think this is the funniest piece of scripture ever. So Isaiah says, oh, okay, and when's it going to happen? Hezekiah says, when's it going to happen? And Isaiah says back to him, not until in the distant future. And Hezekiah says, oh, good. There'll be peace and security in my days. Everything's fine. Are we like that? If it's all about me and I'm okay, the world is okay. But then in chapter 40, we see a completely different idea about God. And sin and judgment are still going to be punished, but God will be with the people. He will comfort them, and he will be in the mess with them. And chapter 40 begins that assurance of how that will happen in the future. So now, let's hear the word of the Lord. Chapter 40. Comfort, oh comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. That's God's comfort. And then he goes on to say, starting in verse 27, why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. This is the word of the Lord. Please pray with me. Lord, we do thank you for your word to us, that you know us so well. So open our hearts and our minds to hear your word, and let your Holy Spirit interpret it to our hearts. In Christ's name, amen. Author and journalist David Brooks writes in his new book, The Second Mountain, that for six decades, 60 years, the worship of self has been the central preoccupation of our culture. We have normalized selfishness, and there is fallout. Think about it. Think how our culture is. It's all about me. Selfishness has caused separation, division, and alienation in the ways we relate to one another and see ourselves as standalone individuals. We've lost the ability to bond together, but I have to say a little parenthesis here. I think we do that pretty well at Mountain View. But in the larger community, we seem to have lost the ability to bond together. We're all on our phones. We're looking at our phones. I was talking to Mike Helms before church, and he said he was at a restaurant, and everybody was sitting looking at their phones. Nobody was talking. The bonding has been lost, and that seems to lead to a shocking rise in distrust, mental illness, and even suicide. Now, all of this sounds like a dire prediction for society as a whole, but Brooks concludes there is hope. Most of the time, he says, we aim too low. We walk in shoes that are too small for us, not understanding the joy that is set before us. And so we come back to verse 1 in Isaiah. Comfort. Comfort my people, says your God. That verse is like a long sigh to us and the people of Israel. It's a relief after 39 chapters of the predictions of exile and calamity that are to come. And God is there. He is ready, even in exile, even in expulsion from normal life, to be with them and to be with us in the midst. Comfort's like a balm on our society. Picture yourself on a Sunday afternoon, maybe in the fall or winter. You're in your recliner, you've got your favorite drink and some chips next to you, maybe you've got your Snuggie on. You don't do that? Watching football is coming. And feeling comfy and cozy. We'd like to be comfortable. In Latin, the word comfort is much different than our understanding of it. And the word for comfort in this scripture means not to be comfy, not to be cozy, but to be strong. God is promising them in chapter 40, verses 1 and 2, this is all going to happen, but I will be with you and make you stronger. I will build a fort around you, so that you may withstand whatever is to come. Instead of God offering to make us softer, he's offering to make us stronger, to stand on our own two feet, to make us bold. The Boston Marathon was a few weeks ago. I'm sure many of you saw news reports on that, and this was my favorite story out of the Boston Marathon this year. There are always so many stories. Those people train so hard and run for 26.2 miles. I don't see how anyone does that. This story was about a Marine veteran who was running for his buddies who were right next to him when they were blown up by an IED. And he has on his shoes little plaques with their names, and he's running for them. Now, I'm sure he trained well. I'm sure he was ready for the race. But on this particular day, at mile 22, his legs began to give out. But he was not going to give up. And so he began to walk. And when he couldn't walk, he crawled. And we see here on the right, this guy doing the army crawl. And there were other pictures showing that the skin had peeled back from his forearms. But he finished the race. He said, and he wouldn't let anyone help him. He said, I'm a Marine. And a Marine finishes by himself. He was on a mission to honor his fallen comrades. He finished the mission with strength and with a spirit he didn't know he probably had. And in the end, when all of the people, all the newspaper reporters and TV reporters were interviewing him, he was uncomplaining and grateful. He not only had finished the race, but he reached his goal. You know, in this scripture, after God promises to comfort the people, and then we jump to verse 27, Israel's complaining again. And God says, why do you complain? Don't you know? Have you not heard? I'm with you. When things don't go our way, we often complain. At least I do. Our plan seems perfect. Don't you know this, God? I planned this out. Or at least our plan is doable, or more often expedient. And then we expect God to fill in the blanks, to come along beside us when we mess it up. And you know what? He often does. But not in ways we would expect. In a book I recently read called The Choir, you have to listen to this. This book is called Barking to the Choir. Preaching to the choir is the terminology, but barking to the choir comes from how an inner city gang member interpreted the words preaching to the choir. The book is written by Father Gregory Boyle, who is founder of Homeboy Industries in inner city Los Angeles. At one point early in his ministry, Father Boyle needed to have $10,000 to meet payroll. Now you can imagine these gang members. He's convinced them God is in their lives. He has gotten them off the streets. They're working for him. They're gainfully employed, and he doesn't have payroll. I can imagine he was worried about them going back to the streets with what they had been doing. The day before payday, a woman drove up in an old bucket of a car. She got out of the car, looking like a bag lady, carrying an old paper sack all wadded up, and she asked one of the homeboys to get Father Greg. He came out to meet her, and she handed him this sack. And she said, "I found this under my late husband's mattress. He always admired your work so much. I knew it must have been for you." And Father Greg opened the bag, and in it was $12,000, $2,000 more than he needed. But Father Greg, even though God had provided, there's a lesson here. He says, look deeper. What is God saying here? Yes, God did provide the money I needed. But even if he hadn't, God would have been with me in what was to come. You see, nothing depends on how things turn out, only on how we view them through God's eyes. God is tenderly with us in all we experience. He walks through it with us. He sustains us in everything if we let him. Now, God was not going to stop the coming storm and the exile to Babylon for the people of Israel. He wouldn't stop it, and he wouldn't protect them from it. But he would be in Babylon with them, and God is in our Babylons, our exiles, whatever that may be. And so instead of complaining to God, we can turn toward God. Now, the definition of repentance is a 180, turning all the way around and going a different direction. And sometimes when we turn toward God, we don't make that 180. We just make it a little bit. And then we test it. Have you ever done that? I'm going to turn to you. I'm going to see if you're there, Lord. But as any good prophet should do, Isaiah refocuses and he resets the vision of what God is doing rather than what we are doing. Remember, we're reading prophecy here. And when the people of Israel went into exile, they would be there 70 years, enough time for a generation to pass away and a new one to be born to rebuild the community that had been lost. We as people, including Israel, want immediate satisfaction. And God often is a God of delayed gratification. It's I want it now versus what is God teaching me? What is God up to? In captivity, Israel would tire of waiting, tire of being disregarded as they perceived it. And I know many of us feel that way from time to time. I saw a news story last week of a young man who was an aspiring journalist. He actually was doing quite well as a journalist. He was young. And he was being interviewed because he had been a millennial who, instead of following what his dream had been, he changed it and turned and went the other way. And when he did that, he gave up what looked like a sure bet as a career. You see, he had gone to the best schools. He had spent a lot of money and social capital to become a lawyer. And then he had been hired by one of the top New York firms. His dream should have been complete. And on the day he walked into that new job with all the other newly minted lawyers, and he was standing there, he felt empty. He felt sad. He knew he didn't belong. It wasn't what he wanted to do.
And most of us would say to ourselves, I've spent all this money and all this time. I'm going to be a lawyer, by golly, and I'm going to make all this money, and I'm going to keep going. This guy turned around. He went to the man who would be his future boss, and he said, I've made a mistake. I don't belong here. There's something else for me. And he walked out the door. Isn't that amazing and gutsy? And if I were his parents, I would have killed him. Maybe my family is not fulfilling all my needs. Maybe God has forgotten me as I suffer from illness and depression and joblessness, relational divisions, or just a deep desire for more than I have. And God says, why do you complain? Don't you know? Haven't you heard? The Lord will not grow tired and weary. His understanding no one can fathom. And the Lord says through his prophet, I will give strength to the weary. If you're tired of where you are, of what's going on in your life, I will give strength. I will surround you with that fort, and I will bring my comfort to you. God is very specific about his strength. It's given to those who wait on the Lord. The word in Hebrew for wait and hope are the same. And so we could translate this as those who are in waiting hope for the Lord. Waiting hope is that patience and perseverance that takes us through the tough stuff. It's an active waiting, not a passive, oh poor me. It is worship to actively wait and hope for the Lord. It is idolatry if we sit around trust what God has for us because it's not what we think should be his plan. You know, there are lots of forms of idolatry. We think that the worship of the golden calves in the book of Exodus is idolatry. But idolatry is whenever we put anything before God, our wants, our needs, our hopes, our fears, anything that comes before God is idolatry. And selfishness reigns. God's intervention is not always as we would expect. Father Greg shares one other poignant story about a boy named Brian who dropped out of the program and found himself incarcerated again. When Father Greg went to visit him, they were talking and the atmosphere began to change. And Brian became quiet. And he said, you know, I think I'm supposed to be here. I don't know what would have happened to me if I'd not been put back in prison. And Father Greg, I've learned to pray. I love to pray. I love to talk to God. All of us have times when in the midst of something terrible, we find release. This man, this young man named Brian, had found release in prison. God provides what we do not possess, power and strength, when we are at our weakest. And then he releases us to soar. And he uses the image of the eagle. And when I was living in Gig Harbor many years ago, I was talking on the phone in my living room, and we had big picture windows that looked out at a huge stand of pine trees and a little bit of Puget Sound. Eagles would come and land in those branches, and sometimes they nested there, but more often they just stopped for a rest. And on this particular day, there was an eagle in one of the pine trees, and I saw him begin to take flight. And it was a gorgeous day, and as he began to take flight, he was coming straight for our windows. And I was scared, because I thought he would hit the windows, as smaller birds had done. But instead, as he came toward those windows, he tilted his wings just in time. He picked up another current. He flew between my house and my neighbor's house, and I could have touched him. I could see his eyes. He trusted the instinct that he had to guide him through possible mess of running into our windows, the possible disaster that could have happened. The eagle was doing what he knew how to do. He avoided the collision that could have been inevitable. The marathon runner ran and grew weary, but he kept going. Those who wait hopefully on God keep running the race set before them, maybe on their knees, or as one Folsom inmate put it, I have grabbed God's outstretched hand, going for a walk. Please pray with me. Lord, thank you that we can grab your outstretched hand and walk with you no matter what. Walk with you through difficulty, walk with you through joy, and wait hopefully for what you have for us.